Wilma Subra, president of Subra Company. Ms. Subra provides technical assistance to citizens concerned with their environment and human health by combining technical research and evaluation. This information is then presented to community members so that strategies may be developed to address their local struggles. She has a BS and MS in microbiology and chemistry from the University of Southwestern Louisiana, University of Louisiana at Lafayette. Ms. Subra's current work is focused on the environmental impacts of various aspects of shale development, the human health impacts associated with various specific units and activities of shale development, the development of appropriate parameters for monitoring groundwater and surface water resources to detect impacts of shale development, and development of guidelines for the regulation of state programs dealing with shale gas development. In 2011, she chaired the Environmental Protection Agency Technical Workshop for the Hydraulic Fracturing Study on Chemical and Analytical Methods. She participated in the EPA Technical Roundtables on Water Acquisition, Chemical Mixing, and Well Injection in November 2012. She co-chaired the EPA Analytical Chemical Methods Workshop in February of 2013. Ms. Subra received the MacArthur Fellowship Genius Award from the MacArthur Foundation in 1999 for helping ordinary citizens understand, cope with, and combat environmental issues in their communities. She also received the 2011 Domestic Human Rights Award from the Global Exchange for her dedication to human rights issues. We are so honored to have Wilma Subra here. She's also been in both Gasland 1 and Gasland 2, if you've seen those films. Thank you.
So thank you for inviting me to come. We are going to look at the AIM project. As it stands now, they're looking to modify 5 of the existing compressor stations that are already on the AIM pipeline. They're looking to modify 25 existing metering and regulatory stations. And these are where they actually measure how much gas is flowing through the pipeline and also how much gas is flowing out into the distribution pipelines from their pipeline. And then they're going to construct 2 new metering and regulatory stations. So this is what their emissions look like as they reported to both FERC and the State Environmental Agency. These are the 5 compressors. They're located 2 in New York, Stony Point and Southeast, 2 in Connecticut, and 1 in Rhode Island. And on the back wall, there is the pipeline route. So you can see it just goes through a corner of Rhode Island. The Stony Park volatile organic emissions, looking at these charts, is larger than the mini sink one that currently is operating for the last couple of months in Mini Sink. And I'd just like to tell you that the citizens of Mini Sink are already having health impacts from the operation of the Mini Sink compressor, and the Stony Point one will be larger than the Mini Sink. So when we look at nitrogen oxide, you heard Matt mention it. It's from the combustion engines running and also from burning of the hydrocarbons. These compressor stations, the 2 in New York, have the highest emissions. Those emissions are in tons per year, and those emissions are based on normal operating conditions, not upsets, not bypass, and not emissions being given off as a result of accidental releases. The Stony Point and the Southeast one are the highest concentrations, and then the other 3 are slightly smaller. But when you look at the Southeast one, you see it's almost twice the concentration of the one at Stony Point, New York, whereas it was the other way around for the volatile organics in tons per year. So the question is, are there different technologies being used, or the remaining of the compressors that are currently there, are they having an impact as well? So this is something we will look at as we continue the review process. So now we look at sulfur dioxide, the rotten egg component. And once again, you see the 2 highest concentrations are in the New York compressors, Stony Point and Southeast. And they are 3.6 tons a year and 4.1 tons a year. And they are also, the two in New York, larger than the mini sink. So if you want to experience what it's like to live by a compressor station and you live in New York, you may want to go out to the community of mini sink, visit there in the area, breathe deeply and inhale the emissions and see if you start encountering any health impacts. And while you're out there, you might want to knock on a few doors and talk to the people, and they will tell you what it's like. And remember, the New York ones, the two on the Ames pipeline, will have higher emissions on an ongoing basis. So the compressor stations along a pipeline are used to push the natural gas through the pipeline. If you didn't have the compressor stations, the natural gas wouldn't flow through the pipelines. During operations, the compressor releases combustion products, the nitrogen oxide, and the volatile organics that we just looked at, their proposed emissions. And they release it into the air, and it degrades the air quality. If you want to experience the air quality degradation, go visit the one in mini sink. These combustion products combine with the volatiles, and in the presence of heat and sunlight during the summer, they produce ground-level ozone. This ground-level ozone causes respiratory system problems, lung function problems, and cardiovascular system problems. Children who have asthma have really severe attacks when the ozone concentration goes up. People with cardiovascular systems have a really negative impact when the ozone goes up. And what happens is the day begins and those nitrogen oxide and volatiles are given off, they mix in the presence of the sunlight and the heat, and they start increasing the ozone concentration. And about noon to 2 o'clock is the high point in the ozone concentrations, and then it starts tapering down until the sun goes out. So a lot of people experience the respiratory problems. As the day progresses around noon, 2 o'clock, they feel really bad, and then they start feeling better as the concentration goes down. But frequently, they don't associate it with what's going on at the compressor stations. And also, if you have family over or friends over for something during the midday, they might tell you, I really need to go home because I really feel bad. And then a couple days later, they'll call you or they'll send you a note and say, I'm sorry, but I don't think I can come back to your house because whatever it is in the area of your house makes me feel really bad when I'm visiting you. So this data is based on analysis in communities. It includes data from Louisiana, Texas, Wyoming, Colorado, and I intentionally didn't put in the Pennsylvania data that Nadia and I worked on because I thought she was going to do that part of the presentation. So I know people hated chemistry in high school. This is the only chemistry slide you'll have to see. But let's look at the chemicals. Benzene, known human cancer-causing agent, causes leukemia. The toluene, ethylbenzene, and xylene cause developmental problems and a lot of the acute impacts. The butadiene, the butyl alcohol, and then you get to the sulfur compounds, the rotten egg compounds, very, very toxic. And then you see some more benzene chemicals. And then on the top of the second row, you see formaldehyde. Formaldehyde's what you used to use in the biology lab in high school to put the tissue in. It's what people use in medical labs to preserve the tissue that they remove in order to slice it up and see what you have in your tissue. It's a known human cancer-causing agent, and it's released by these facilities. And then you see some more sulfur compounds. And when you get to the naphthalene, it's a polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbon. Polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons are semi-volatiles, and they're very persistent in the environment. Some of the major toxic components of the crude oil in the BP spill are polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons. That happened in 2010, and we're still having those polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons wash ashore in the form of tar balls, tar strings, and mats. I have communities that are contaminated with creosote waste that has a lot of polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons, and it's been 30, 40, 50, and 60 years, and it bioaccumulates in their bodies, and it's still very present. So these emissions, when they settle down and contaminate groundwater, surface water, soil, sediment, and biota, both vegetation and animal life, they will bioaccumulate in those and organisms, and also they will be very long-lasting in the environment. So then we do lose down to methane. Methane is a major component of natural gas, and the industry will tell you it's not toxic, it's an explosive hazard, and it's a fire hazard, but quote, it's just methane, it's not toxic. But then you look at the ethane, the butane, and the propane, are the other components that are there in lesser quantities in the natural gas, and they are toxic. So don't be fooled by them just trying to convince you that methane is only an explosive hazard. Acute health impacts are the ones that occur after a short-term exposure, and these are actual health impacts from citizens living in the area and or working in the area of compressor stations. At the bottom, you'll see 90% of the individuals that live or work within 2 to 3 miles of compressor stations report experiencing odor events and associated health impacts. So we have a 2 to 3 mile radius that has severe health impacts, 2 to 3 mile radius from the compressor stations. So if you go visit Minisink, go out 2 to 3 miles and see how big an area, see how many people live in that area. So looking at the acute health impacts from people that we've surveyed, they have irritation to the skin, eyes, nose, throat, and lungs. They have respiratory impacts, sinus problems, allergic reactions, headaches, dizziness, nausea, vomiting, skin rashes, fatigue, and weakness. They also have tense and nervous attacks. They have joint and muscle aches and pains. They have vision impairment. They have personality changes, depression, anxiety, irritability, confusion, drowsiness, weakness, and irregular heartbeat. The majority of the symptoms in the second column are what really impacts quality of life and the social structure in a household. One member of the household can have some of these impacts. It's very difficult for the family to admit that they're having these. And the wife will look at the husband and say, why are you so irritable today? Why are you in such a bad mood? You must have had a night's sleep that didn't work or something. And when it keeps going on and on and on, the level of tension and level of depression in the household starts building. And the quality of life in the household starts degrading. And yet people don't associate it back to what's going on in their exposure to the emissions from the compressor stations. These are chronic, long-term health impacts from exposure to long-term exposure. And these are from people working and living close to the compressors, damage to the liver and kidneys, the lungs, the cardiovascular system, damages developing fetus, reproductive damage, mutations, malformations, damage to the nervous system, brain, leukemia, anemia, and changes to the blood cells. When you go to the doctor and he diagnoses you with cancer or precancerous conditions, he might ask you what your occupation is to figure out what you may have been exposed to at work. He's not going to ask you, what do you live near, what's around you, what may be releasing these chemicals that may have caused your condition. There's a real need to educate the healthcare providers about what chemicals are being released, what health impacts are associated with those chemicals, so they can attempt to do something about not only treating your condition, but attempting to reduce your exposure. Most of the doctors, when you're diagnosed with cancer, are dealing with the issues of treatment and dealing with the stress put on the family and not trying to figure out what caused it And trying to figure out what caused it, you may be able to reduce the number of additional cases that could be caused. So we look at the health impacts that are associated with living near both compressor stations and gas metering stations, both of which will be on the AIM project. And at the bottom, you see that 61% of the health impacts are associated with chemicals present in the air in excess of the long and short-term screening levels. So in addition to the health surveys, we did air sampling. And a large number of the chemicals were present over a level established by the state, in excess of those levels. And these are the health impacts from those chemicals: nasal irritation, throat irritation, burning eyes, frequent nausea, sinus problems, bronchitis, increased fatigue, muscle aches and pain, severe headache, dizziness, weakness and tired, decreased motor skill, depression, frequent irritation, severe anxiety. And again, those at the end of the list are the ones that really disrupt what's going on in the family. So the next slide are the health impacts from that same survey. And these are the chemicals that were present in the air, but not in excess of the standards established by the state. But you have the cumulative impacts of being exposed to all of those chemicals at one time as you live or work in the area. Allergies, persistent cough, shortness of breath, frequent nosebleeds, sleep disturbance, joint pain, difficulty in concentrating, nervous system impacts, forgetfulness, sore and ulcers in the mouth, and thyroid problems. This is what you, the community, have to look forward to living in the area of the 5 compressor stations along the Ames pipeline. When we look at how the pipelines operate and what's needed from the community perspective, you need to evaluate the ability of the monitoring equipment along the pipeline to determine changes in flow rates and pressure and the time frame for detecting the leaks. There was a pipeline rupture in Michigan, and 17 hours after it occurred, it was still flowing. And it was crude oil. It wasn't natural gas, but it was crude oil. And in those 17 hours, the operators in all the control rooms along the pipeline were arguing about what the bells and whistles and lights flashing really meant. And after 17 hours, they finally decided among themselves that there was a pipeline leak. But they didn't really decide among themselves. Somebody saw it flowing out of the ground and called emergency response, who called the pipeline company and said, "You have a leak." And then the guys in the control room said, "Oh, that's what it meant." And they shut off the valves that isolated that segment. The issue was that 4 to 5 tests on that pipeline demonstrated that that one segment of pipe had anomalies in it over a very long period of time. And those 4 to 5 monitoring tests were never incorporated into the whole process. After the first one, they should have gone in and investigated that segment of pipe and replaced it. And they kept ignoring it and showed up in the next test, showed up in the next test. So the question is that the kind of company you want operating a pipeline in your area? Then you need to determine how much time is needed to shut down those 2 valving stations and how much gas will be released before that part of the pipeline is empty. In Minisink, about 3 weeks ago, we had a blowdown. And in Minisink, they have to notify the community within a half mile, 5 days in advance, of having a blowout, a blowdown, so that they can leave the area if they so choose. So the citizens actually took samples, and during that event, it lasted some 17 hours of just venting the gas between those 2 valving stations. Those are huge quantities released into the air, and they don't count and those slides at the beginning where we talked about the permitted emissions. So when pipeline operations, you need to evaluate the distance between those valving stations. And what kind of sensitive environments are between each valving station that you need to look at when you have an event? You need to model those areas between the valving station and how big an area of impact. Before 9/11, companies were required to do vulnerable zone calculations for each of the chemicals that were toxic or explosive, and that data was publicly available. And then as a result of 9/11, that data has been pulled back and is not available. So even if you get them to do the modeling, they don't have to release it to you. So you need to ask them to do the modeling and to release it to the public. And then you need for them to determine and tell you the rate of preventing maintenance and monitoring. From a number of the pipeline events, it was clear that there were minimum standards by the pipeline division, and yet the companies were not measuring up to those minimum standards, and the regulatory agency wasn't checking to see if they had been doing those minimum standards. So there was fault enough to go around from the company itself and from the regulatory agency. So then we look at emergency response. Compressor stations are an explosive hazard, a fire hazard, and both and a toxic hazard. The methane, as we talked earlier, is the explosive and fire hazard. The toxins that release into the environment are the toxic problems. And when they have leaks and spills, they can go off-site and contaminate surface water, groundwater, soil, sediment, and biota. The Marcellus Shale has a large quantity of radioactive components that contaminate from the Marcellus Shale formation. When you go down and frack that formation and then start producing, the flowback water comes in contact with the formation and brings to the surface the radioactive material. And the gas, as it flows to the surface, is contaminated with the radioactive material. Radium-226 and 228 are the large components of that radioactivity, and it causes bone cancer and lung cancer. The routes of exposure are inhalation and ingestion. And radium-226 has a half-life of 1,620 years, so it's going to be there for a very long time. And the radon gas will be in both the gas that's distributed through the compressor station, and the norm will precipitate out in the compressor station, and it looks like dust or sand. And it's very radioactive and will be contaminating the area around the compressor station. The County Emergency Response Agency is the first responder in a 9/11 event. No matter who owns the pipeline, who owns the compressor station, the county emergency responders are the ones that respond. And also, they're the ones that decide whether you do an evacuation or a shelter in place. Sometimes they do it in cooperation with the company itself. Other times, they have to make those decisions quickly. And they are the ones that respond to the events at both compressor stations as well as pipelines. And it's very complex. Is it just the gas? Is the gas explosive? When the gas migrates out and hits an ignition source, could it be a mile away and then you have a large explosion? Is the gas fire on the site? And the emergency responders have to deal with all those situations, and they need to deal with it now. So they need adequate training. They need adequate preparation. They need adequate equipment. They need adequate supplies. If you need foam to stop a fire, they need to have foam on site that's sufficient for them to respond, and also that hasn't expired in usefulness. And the company that owns the compressor station and the pipeline should be the one that provides the resources necessary to train them, to prepare them, to provide the equipment, and also to provide the supplies. It can take a huge amount of effort to respond to one event, that the county has to pay out, and it can actually run a budget. It can be as much as half of the year's budget for one response, and then the response agency lacks the resources to continue operating. So there also is a need for a mechanism for the agency that they are under to bill the responsible party and get quick payment so that that money flows back in and doesn't come out of the taxpayers' pockets to respond to these events. So what government agencies are responsible? Local government needs to identify the resources, training, equipment, and staffing that they will need to respond. The local government should establish that mechanism to quickly recover the costs. The compressor stations are regulated by state environmental agencies, which give them the permit. And you heard Matt talk briefly about the permits, the permit into the air. The Department of Transportation and Pipeline Hazard actually has some regulatory authority. The pipelines are regulated by the FERC, Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and the U.S. Department of Transportation. And then frequently, state and federal regulatory programs lack of adequate resources. So what you'll see is the state program has a permitting for the air emission permit, but they don't have sufficient resources to come out in the field and do frequent inspections and monitor the data that's submitted to the agency and also to issue compliance orders. And at the federal level, it's clear based on the most recent pipeline events that the federal agencies do not have the resources to inspect, monitor, issue compliance orders, and ensure compliance with the regulations. So the shale production in Pennsylvania, Ohio, and West Virginia are causing a tremendous amount of infrastructure development in the area. There's a real push to provide natural gas to the Northeast customers. There's a push to encourage the use of natural gas to replace fuel oil. They need fuel, as in natural gas, to fire electric generating plants. Right down from the mini sink compressor, they received a permit for a gas generating power plant. There's a need to provide natural gas to LNG, liquefied natural gas export facilities. And there's a need to provide natural gas to liquid and gas fractionation facilities. Historically, Louisiana has exported to you in the Northeast most of the natural gas you use. During the summer, we send it up here and you put it in production formations that have been depleted. Now, you're sending a lot of the shale gas from Pennsylvania, Ohio, and West Virginia down to Louisiana and to the coastal areas. There's a facility known as Cove Point. That's a liquefied natural gas export facility. It has received DOE approval in September of 2013 to export to non-free trade agreement countries. In October of 2011, it received approval from DOE to export to free trade agreement countries. And there are three facilities that have already received DOE/FERC approval, two in Louisiana, one in Texas. And the FERC schedule shows that the Cove facility on Chesapeake Bay is up next for its FERC certification. So a lot of the gas that is going to come through your area is targeted to be exported to the Cove facility for export to free trade and non-free trade agreement countries. Thank you very much.